feeling like?
Oh, it's, you know, it's excitement, you know, and then I think for a lot of different reasons. Number one, I love these guys. They're just, it's a joy to wake up every morning and get to come coach them. And that's not, you know, I'm not cliche. I'm not, you know, but you guys have heard me talk about this team, and that's been consistent, you know. Even when we have bad days, it's great. I mean, it's amazing. They're, you know, I think we've been grinding a long, long time, and I swear we've had 1.5 bad practices. And not even bad, just maybe not to the standard. Now, does that mean we don't have any work? No, we got a lot of work to do. Because every team, they come out of the gate with some strengths, but they also come out of the gate with a lot of things you got to get better at. And they're pretty much what you'd think about this time of year. We've got to get a heck of a lot better defensively, I think. We've got to get our more experience at the 1-5, and there's only one way to do that, is get them out there. You know, they're good, they're really good players, and but it's to the point where they need just to grow with game experience in our system, you know, because that's you look at our 5 spot. Omar's in a new role for himself. Cam hasn't played for 900 days or whatever it might be. So there's a lot where experience is needed at this point. And then Jace and Roddy, you know, they're both sophomores with they've gotten some quality experience, but, you know, as compared to Buzo, Tyson, Max, not as much. So those are the things that we're getting after but you need some games to do it. And, you know, the exciting thing is Tuesday, first of all, I played that game on Tuesday so y'all could watch Kellen Moore on Monday night. So I knew Bronco fans would appreciate that. So let's come out, let's watch these guys. This is a counting game. I think some people get confused at the calendars of college basketball and what we can do. And the rule is you're allowed 2 either exhibitions or scrimmage or 1-1, whatever it is. And we played 2 closed door scrimmages. This is a counting game to start with. And, you know, so we need fans there because, you know, we need fans, first of all, come out and see these guys. They're great and they're fun to watch and, you know, you're going to help them grow. But we need to get comfortable in our arena in front of our fans because there's always some game slippage the first time you get out, you know, and do a live play. So it's important for these guys to get that experience and we need to have a great opening night.
You talk about the experience for the new guys and your experience, no pun intended, just how long does that usually take? How many games does that take for them to really get? Or is it kind of a...
Yeah, it just depends. I've seen some guys and I think, you know, because they're a little bit older, they learn quick, you know, maybe quicker than some, you know, but you hate to stereotype it because sometimes you'll have a freshman that just, I mean, when Tyson was thrown to the fire, he learned quickly. You know, everybody saw that right in front of them. And I think we've got some really smart guys that'll do it that way, too.
And you talked about Omar having a different role. What was his role at St. John's and what he wanted to be?
Well, they had a big, giant center. And he just kind of seemed like he played more on the perimeter as far as maybe not to his complete strengths all the time. And I'm not knocking them. I'm just, you know, the personnel was different and the system was different. And so I think it's just getting accustomed to where he fits and where, you know, where he belongs and where he can play to his strengths. And that's what we're really working on. And because he's got some definite strengths. And, you know, I told a fellow coach that the great thing about Omar is he's good at all the things we can't teach. He's not great at all the things we can teach yet. You know, so there's that equals an upside. Because I know we can teach a lot of the things that he's not, you know, not that he's bad at them, but I'm talking about at an elite level, you know. So I'm, you know, we're excited to get him more and more experience, and I'm just seeing growth every day.
And with Cam, this is the 4th program he's played for now. I mean, how valuable is that experience both in the locker room and on the floor?
Yeah, and that's like with Cam, that's why the Canadian trip was so important because, you know, you saw his first shot, it was an air ball. You know, there's always some jitters. There's always some, you know, excitement, and whether it's, you call it jitters, whether you call it whatever, there's always that. And that doesn't change whether you're 25, whether you're 60 or 58, or, you know, it's always there. And it actually made, I paused today and thought about a great Bobby Knight story that I was actually really good friends with his son, still am. And we were playing in Alaska, and we had gotten done playing. We were in the Alaska Shootout, one of the last years there. And we'd got done playing, and Texas Tech, I believe, was playing right after us. And Mark and I were kind of wandering the hallway, and we see Coach Knight, his team had gone out to warm up, and I think he invited us in the locker room for a second. And, you know, he's just sitting there, and you could just see the anguish in his face and the, you know, the nervousness before a game. And you know, Mark and I were just young, somewhat young coaches. And we were like, Coach, you know, after all these years, butterflies and, you know, that pregame stuff is still there. And he goes, it never leaves. It never leaves. And Mark and I looked at each other and were like, dang it. We thought like we'd get this thing figured out, and in 20 years those would never leave. And so, like, even like I said, like, these guys are excited, I'm excited, you know, I get the you know, the juice going for us to get going, and because it's a long grind in the off season. And nowadays you just, you know, Max said it, like, man, this seems like the month, because we took a foreign trip too, so we practiced more, played a little bit more. And it is, you know, and can you imagine being, I mean, there hasn't been many players in the history of college basketball, 6 years in one program. So, you know, you're fighting through that. And I think our guys did a really, really good job this fall camp. I mean, it was impressive, the practices we had and the consistency we practiced with. But to do what we want to do, we have to get a lot better. I mean, you know, we got good pieces, but it's hard to win. You know, I mean, everyone wants you to win every game. It's hard to win one game. It's hard. And there's great player nowadays in college basketball. You look all over the landscape, you're seeing all these upsets of high name schools against the seventh place team in an NAI league. Yeah, but it's, you see this all the time. And if you're not ready to play, if you don't play a good game, and that doesn't mean making shots every night and all that thing, but being able to defend, being able to rebound, being able to have a consistency of performance. And when you have a team with some new guys, you don't know what you're going to get yet. And we have a lot of veterans, and so that's the X factor that you do know, but there's also things that we don't know yet. And so that it gets you excited as a coach, and hopefully the fans are excited to see these guys, because they're going to enjoy them. These guys will battle and they'll play together and all the things that you want out of a team.
What is the plan at point guard? I know a lot of people just assumed that Roddy was going to come in and it was his job, but I mean, in Canada, you know, Jace really looked impressive.
Sure.
And we've only seen one practice, you know, in the last month, but I mean, how exactly is that going to be a 50-50 split? Is Jace pushing for the starting spot? Or
I envision it as it's always a work in progress, because, you know, I always tell these guys this, you look at our starting lineup on day one. First of all, I don't overdo starting lineup. I don't care that much. Fans care more. Sometimes players, you know, to be fair, I ask the players, like, sometimes they really care, sometimes they don't. But it's about minutes. And so I think it's, you know, I got to have a feel for who can do what in what situations. I got to have a feel for who's best in what situations, whether it's matchups, whether it's style of play, all those things. But both of them have proven they're worthy of playing. I think you saw that, you know, 2 or 3 months ago, and they're both getting better. So there's not a, you know, that's the thing. It's not an end all, because first of all, who knows what will be, you know, the Jeff Lauriaga story, the Tyson Degenhardt story. There's always been a change. I mean, out of our 14 years, I'd love to know, I don't think I've ever, maybe once, started a team and then that team started throughout the year. I don't think that's ever happened. And so who knows? But I do know both of them are gonna play. And it's not an all or nothing if one starts while the other one lost. Because I know one thing, neither of them will give up, and neither of them are, they both know it's a long-term deal, and hey, there'll be times hopefully when we can play them together because they're a lot different.
How much better did Jace get? I mean, there were, as a freshman, I mean, there were times in San Diego State where he was having trouble getting the ball across half court, sure. And then he had some, you know, strong moments as well. But how is he a different player this year?
Oh, it's just, I mean, you know, he's a freshman. And the thing people they don't take into account, he was gone for 2 years away from basketball on a mission. And that is a big, big jump that first year. You know, you got to get the timing and there's a whole bunch that has to be done for that. And, you know, then just the fact of being a freshman, the long year, the grind and how hard you have to work and the competition, all those things. And so he grew as a freshman and he's doing it now. And the best thing is he got quality experience last year. Roddy got quality experience last year. Now we need those two to not be freshmen, not be sophomores, but be leaders and point guards at a Mountain West level. And both of them have shown really, really good things in the preseason.
I have a similar question with Omar and Cam.
So to answer your question, yes, we have a two quarterback system. It's
well, kind of similar question with Omar and Cam. So it sounds like you kind of are thinking of putting Omar there at the five, and that's what Cam plays too. You know, kind of how do you balance that? And, you know, the time when you can get them both on the court, just how good can your depth?
Well, we've been positionless for a long time, and my thought to that has always been your guys that are playing the best and the guy you got to get them out and don't get caught on the positions. Those two are a lot different. They're just, it's kind of like Roddy and Jace that way. You know what they bring to the team is a lot different from each other, and both those two, you know, one's 25 years old. You know what, you're gonna, from the day you see him Tuesday to the day you see him at the end of the year, you're gonna see a guy that gets a lot better. Just cause, like I said, he hasn't played a real game for 900 days. So we can do everything we can at practice, but there is just a difference of game experience and when guys get into that rhythm of playing and they just keep getting better. And that's what our program's always been about that. And so, yeah, I think we can do some good things right now. I think we're a long way of being where we will be in a couple months and where we can be. So, you know, but I like the place we're starting from.
There's been a lot of, obviously, talk about Max and Tyson, and they both went to media days, and they're the ones showing off the new jerseys and a lot of that stuff. And, you know, but Buzo is kind of part of that trio, too. What, you know, where is his game and you know, getting that year under his belt where he played and was a star and took big shots? Where is he going to be a better player this year?
Yeah, he's had jaw-dropping days at practice, you know, and that's just part of the growth. And usually what you see as a coach is you see those jaw-dropping days, then you see more of them, and then you see a consistency of it where it's like every day you go to practice and you're like, wow. And, you know, that's just the growth. And I've seen that with Chandler. I've seen that, you know, the guys that go on to really great things. And Buzo's shown some of that. And so it's just a matter of just being consistent and being able to repeat that in games every single night out. And, you know, because last year you saw what it was at the start.
Yeah, he was airballing shots like Cam was.
He was airballing and he fell down in 9 minutes. That, you talk about, you know, that's not normal. You know, 9 minutes is...
You call that 2 games? Or I know he was foul trouble the first couple there. Yeah, that was...
Yeah, I think the only one that I've ever seen faster than that was me in high school. And one of them was a technical, believe it or not. That guy hit me, so...
Yeah. Talk about consistency. I mean, Tyson just seems like he's the model of consistency. You know, what has he meant to the development of this program over the past 3 years?
It's, you know, you can't overstate it. As far as how much he means to this program, how fortunate we are to have him, and how fortunate this community is to get to have a kid like he's. I've coached a long time, and you don't get a million Tysons. They're not just on every street corner. And I mean, think about it, he was freshman of the year in the league on a really good team. You know, I mean, we won the league, and he was freshman of the year. Well, when I remember reading, Frank Burleson was one of the first ones that really, really, you know, hammered it and said, no, this kid's going to be, he said that, he's going to be freshman of the year. And I remember thinking, yeah, I know he's really good, but that's hard to do when you're on such a good team, because there's a lot of guys that are going to score. There's a lot of guys that are going to rebound. There's a lot of guys that are going to play minutes ahead of you. And for him to do that was pretty remarkable. Then he chases it with a first team all conference in the Mountain West. If you're, there hasn't been guys that make first team all conference that don't go play this game for a lot of money. I mean, if you're a first team all Mountain West player, you're getting paid to play basketball. And he's done that as a sophomore. So, and he's continued to improve now. So, but you know, that's just the performance stuff. I'm not even talking about, you know, it's just he's a straight A student, one of the best leaders I've ever coached, all those things. But the cool thing about it is we've got a group like him, a bunch of guys. I say that they're not a dime a dozen, but they're Tyson level guys in their own way, you know? So that's why, you know, you can see why I enjoy this group so much. Doesn't mean you're not going to go through hard. Every team's going to go through challenges. Every team, and with our schedule, our challenges are coming, and they're coming quickly. So, but when you have a team like that, you can face those challenges, and you can get better, and you can make that's why we call it the unbreakable culture, because you're going to get broken, and if you can't fix yourself, then it is a broken culture. But if it's unbreakable, you'll get yourself up the next day, and the high character guys will fix it. And I mean, that's college basketball. You've got to be able to do that. You're going to go through a valley of death at some point. And hopefully that valley is shorter when you have great players and great character.
And you mentioned Tyson's connection with the community. You know, he's kind of your NIL darling. He's doing autograph sessions. He's got the Degenhardt dozen. Mm-hmm. He's probably the guy on the team that gets recognized the most around town, right?
Yeah.
How have you seen him deal with that level of fame?
Just like you'd expect. He's just, you'd never know it, you know? You'd never know, and that's the best. All these guys are like that, though. Like I said, he's an exceptional person and great. You know, his parents are amazing, and they raised, you know, they got a lot to be proud of, obviously, just like I do. But I got a bunch of guys like that, you know? That's what makes it so special. And it's all up and down the roster. And that's why this program's going to continue to grow and grow and grow. And that's the value of being able to stay at a place for a long time. You just keep getting things better like that. And, you know, I couldn't have got a Tyson Degenhardt the first couple of years when I took this job. You know, you weren't getting those guys recruited. And that's the level of this program changes. And as it keeps changing, that keeps stacking itself. And you know, you just keep getting higher level in every category.
I know a lot of times when you have somebody that's really good, what improves seems to be a little more polished, finer things. But if you're looking at one thing for this year, what would you think would be the thing that Tyson probably will be better at?
Shooting. Yeah. But like I said, he's always been a good shooter. But number one, he's worked on it. He's changed his body, more perimeter-ish. Doesn't mean he's not going to go score on the block, because he's one of the best in the country at that. But people have no idea how good a shooter that guy is. And, you know, last year he's doing 400-pound squats and then, okay, go do a finesse shot. I mean, think about that. He was doing all our heavy lifting last year, a lot of it. And so I think that affected his three-point shot a little bit.
Do you think you talk about having depth and wanting to play guys, not have guys be playing 38 minutes, whatever, if you can, but do you think that you can actually do that, or when crunch time comes around, is your style, your four or five best guys, you want them out there as much as possible? How do you weigh that, I guess?
I think I've even heard you talk about it, and you actually had a good take on it. It's true. I have a thing that I write on the board every day, accomplish the mission, and it's a zero-sum game. I mean, it's not a video game either. You know, the energy went down, we got to change our, you know, it's not like that. You want your best guys out there, and it's their job to prove that they're trustworthy, prove that we know what we're going to get every night. You know, when I'm talking about the bench guys, it's their job to do that. Yeah, you'd like to have a deep enough team that an injury, boom, there's no drop-off. San Diego State, we had an injury to a senior, and a freshman stepped in, and, you know, it was a tough challenge. That's when it makes a difference, is that depth helps you on nights like that. That, you know, our first league game last year was Nevada, correct? We had two key guys foul out. The guys off the bench have to find a way to win that game for you. And if they do, you know, you're right there to win the league. That's the difference in what depth can do for you and development. We've got a great nucleus of veterans and then backed up by a great nucleus of young guys. And I trust them. I trust them. They've earned my trust. You know, it's not my job to just like, okay, I deem you worthy. No, that's, I'd love to deem every kid worthy. They have to prove it. And that's college athletics, you know. But in the end, every player, every person that comes to this arena, every player on this team wants to win. And if I'm not doing everything I can to help them win, whether that's playing a guy for 40 minutes or whether it's subbing a guy for 50 minutes, you know, whatever that is, I have to figure that out. And we have to figure that out, our staff, and do what's best that way. Would I have loved to play more last year? Absolutely. Absolutely.
You mentioned accomplishing the mission. Obviously, the long-term mission is getting that first NCAA tournament win, right? How much are you guys as a coaching staff using that as a motivating factor among the players? Is it not talked about in the locker room? Not at all?
No. That's, you don't make those kind of goals. Mm-hmm. Those are, it's about the process, and it's about the goal of what we're doing today. I mean, that's in March. Mm-hmm. That's like, okay, what are you going to do with your $1 million that you won?
Right.
Well, I first got to win the $1 million, you know, like you can't, you know what I'm saying? Getting to the NCAA tournament is a great accomplishment. Great accomplishment. I get it. This day and age, you're too many programs are judged by that. It's the consistency, the win, and the keep knocking on the door. And then those are going to happen. But if you focused on that, that's nothing, you know, not a good use of your focus. Or it's about putting ourselves in that position, the best position we can be in, so you get a great seed, so you get a great matchup, you got a great location, all those things. Then you got to go out and win, no doubt.
What about you personally? I mean, you've accomplished so much in your career, conference championships, you've put guys in the league. Is that first NCAA tournament win, is that kind of your white whale at this point? I mean,
not at all. No, not at all. And you know, and I say that because I've seen what coaches go through. You know, I've seen Mark Few be. I remember years before he went to a Final Four, there's people on Zag stuff saying, well, it's time for a new guy. He probably can't get. So that became his deal. Like, well, will you be a great coach once you get to the Final Four? There's always, well, now it's like, well, he's got to win the big, you know, I mean, there's always going to be a next mountain. You know, I always tell our guys, you climb a big mountain, what's on top of that mountain? There's not just a green pasture that you get to run slow motion in and, you know, I've arrived. No. There's another mountain, and it's a higher mountain and a harder mountain. Yeah, when I took this job, if you would have been saying, you know, you guys are getting there every year, that's not good enough. You're winning. I mean, when we went to the Mountain West, I was like, we may never win a game in this league. It's such a good league. It's a great basketball league. I mean, we've got three teams that have played for a national championship in this league. Like, that's not happening in any others. You know, three. Think about that. Now, some of them were long ago, but that doesn't matter. That's amazing. And this is a great basketball league. And to say, if you would have told me a long, long time ago that you guys are going to be contending for title every year, you're going to win it, you're going to win the tournament, you're going to be in the NCAA tournament, you're going to get at-large bids, all those things, I'd have been like, wow, that's a big mountain. That's a big mountain. And, you know, so the now we're just onto a bigger mountain. That's great. I love it. That you know, that means that our program's doing stuff.
Well, onto the process of getting there, you know, the non-conference schedule, you know, a lot's been made of it. You know, I think most if not every team had a 500 record or above last season. A lot of NCAA, a lot of NIT teams. You know, what do you hope to learn about this team in the first 12 games of the season?
Well, you got to give, you know, Coach Burns he's got a PhD in scheduling, and I mean, it's not by accident that our numbers are always right there in that large category. We schedule right and aggressive, and you know, it's funny because in the off season, I, you know, we go through all this. I'm like, yeah, let's do that, and then now I get a little bit, and I'm like, oh, wow, where's the easy ones there? But it's what, you know, we got a veteran team, and we need to do that. I mean, we're playing at Clemson. They're in the upper half of the, you know, first of all, we're playing San Francisco. They're picked third in behind. You know, two top 10 teams probably. I mean, St. Mary's right now is, whoa. And you know, they were picked ahead of Gonzaga. And San Francisco picked third, you know. So you're like, wow. And no one's talking about that game like it's like, oh, well, that's not, you know, on to the next ones, on to the No. That is a great team, great coaches, really good players. And then you just stack it. After that, we're going on about a 3-week just binge of great teams and hard places and on and on. So, but that's where you got to have some toughness and some grit and some ability to, you know, keep getting better. And it's going to make us better, no doubt. That's why I was able to do it. I mean, you know, will it be just a cakewalk and will we just win every game by 30? Not a chance. But we're going to compete. I know that.
Is it fair to say this is the most daunting non-conference schedule you face?
You know, it sure seems like it right now, looking down the barrel of it. I mean, wow. Yeah, there's not a lot of free outs.
One team, I think, is outside the top half of KenPom.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Not counting the non-D1s. But right. Northwestern State, I think, is like 3-3, whoever it is.
Right, that's it.
But yeah,
even
175, I think, is the next lowest. Yeah. Fullerton or something.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's just so many more good teams in college basketball now that anybody inside of the top 150 is a good basketball program and good basketball team. And you've seen that.
So after Vanguard, I think you can play like your next five can be like top 90.
Yeah. It's crazy. And, you know, but that's why we did a foreign trip. That's why we, you know, all the things add up. But are we ready? Doesn't matter. We'll find out. Here we go.
Well, even Vanguard, if I remember correctly from my days covering NAIA,
yeah,
they were usually a top-tier NAIA team.
Yeah.
So what do you see? What do you see from them?
Well, you know, as you go into the season, you're really, really focused on how we're going to be, and you know, we will turn the page to them later. You know, like on Saturday, Sunday, Monday. So right now, we're still the focus on us, our process, and get that. But you know, they're always a skilled team that can really shoot. Their coach, you know, we go way back to my JUCO days. He was at Big Bend Community College, and he's a great coach, and they're gonna have a lot of skill and a lot of good shooters. I know that.
Anything else?